Say amen again.
Amen.
Appreciate all you who have prayed for me this week and helped me to get back on my feet. Amen.
Amen.
Thank Brother Mike for taking the class on Wednesday night. I heard he did a fantastic and wonderful job. It's always good to have folks. Be prepared. Yes. The Boy Scouts motto. Always prepared. Amen.
Amen.
So you can find your way to Colossians chapter 1. I want to welcome those who are visiting with us. Say you are indeed our honored guests. We don't take your visit lightly. We certainly appreciate you coming by to hear what thus says the Lord. Y'all just give me a little time, I'll get started. Amen?
Amen.
Might be a little slow, but I'm going to get there. Remember our covenant? If you say amen like you understand, it ain't going to make it no shorter. Amen?
Amen.
I'm just going to go ahead on to the church. I'll try it. Amen?
Amen.
Colossians chapter 1 and verses 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5. The Bible says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in the Lord, in Christ, which are in Colossae. Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We give thanks to God and to the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love which you have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof you heard before in the word of truth of the gospel. Faith, hope, and love.
Yes.
The power of the gospel. Last week I talked to you about this trio that Paul lays out, and I told you some of the things about what was going on in the Colossian church. They had this quest for knowledge, and they were ceremonials who paid more attention to what they wore and what they ate than who they served. They were more caught up on ritual than righteousness. They more wanted to be seen than to be about doing. Are y'all still out there?
Yes.
I gave you a definition of faith, and I told you it came from the word pistis, which simply means to persuade or be persuaded that something is. But it also means to trust in that which you believe in. The word comes from pistuo, which simply means I obey. Faith cannot be faith without obedience.
Yes.
I'll say that again. Faith cannot be faith without obedience. Are y'all still out there?
Yes.
I'm just trying to help you get back into remembering what we talked about last week, and then I'll get into this week. And I gave you an expanded definition of faith, telling you that it's the substance of things that we hope for. That famous verse that we all quote from Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1. We talk about the fact that it's the evidence of things that we have not seen. It is the substance of things that we hope for. And the word simply there, substance, is hupostasis, which simply means to stand on. It means that undergirding, it's that pedestal that holds you up. So faith is that thing that keeps you from falling.
Amen.
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 It sustains you like the girders on the bridge hold the bridge up.
Yes.
The pillow that keeps the bridge from collapsing as you ride across on your vehicle. It's that pedestal that keeps the Christian from falling when the Christian doesn't have anything else to hold on to. We hold on to our faith.
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
But we don't just believe in belief itself. Amen. We can't just believe in belief. We can't just believe what our church believes and hope that our church will believe what we believe, and that we can't hope that we'll believe the same thing. See, we can't just have faith in faith. We have to have an object to have our faith in. And Jesus Christ, ladies and gentlemen, is that object that we believe in. Jesus Christ is the one that we trust in. Jesus Christ is the one that we put our hope in. And I gave you another word. I didn't really tell it to you, but it's amethokinethos. And amethokinethos simply means that I cannot be moved. Like that tree that is planted by the rivers of water.
Yes.
I shall not be moved. I am not going to be moved. I will not be moved. I'm like those trees on Lebanon, those cedars on Lebanon. I wrap myself around the rock of ages. And no matter what winds blow, no matter what rains come, no matter how turbulent the water might be, I shall not be moved. And that doesn't mean that I'm not going to move up my pew when I see something needs to be done. Somebody ought to say amen. Doesn't mean that I'm not going to get stuck in one position. It doesn't mean that when guests come by, I'm not going to get up because this is my favorite seat. That's not the kind of not moving we're talking about. Not just being on the premises waiting on the promises. Y'all still there?
Yes.
That not being moved means that you are anchored in the Lord.
Yes. Yeah.
Like the Israelites when they were traveling through the wilderness. Somebody ought to say amen. By night they had a pillar of fire. By day it was a pillow, a cloud that was leading them where they wanted to go. And wherever the cloud went, wherever the fire went, they followed because they were anchored in the Lord. Somebody say, help me. That's the kind of, I'm not going to be moved. I'm not going to move out of my Father's house. Because in my Father's house, I know that everything is going to be all right. When I get up in the morning, I'm going to be in my Father's house.
I'm
not going to move from the Word of God, because the Word of God is what helps me to sustain in this turbulent world. When everything else around me is going bad, I know that in my Father's house, everything is going to be all right. I shall not be moved. Y'all still out there?
Yes.
This morning I come to finish this sermon. If you help me, it's by saying amen. Amen. I'm still moving a little slow, but y'all can please help if you can. Help me out. I appreciate Brother Weekly trying to get us motivated this morning. You sounded good.
Yeah.
And Paul says, not only do I remember your faith, but I also remember the love which you have for all the saints. Y'all got time?
Yes, sir.
It's a beautiful thing. When you see in the church love for all the saints. Let me say that a little bit slow. It is a beautiful sight to see in the church love for some of the saints. And he said all the saints. I just wanted to make sure my Bible read like your Bible. Because sometimes our Bible read differently. Sometimes you do like I do. We look at stuff and we reinvent what it says. Not just for some of the saints. Not just for the lovable, amen, but for all the saints. That means those that you can't stand. Amen? And we don't believe that you have to die to become a saint. I'll say that again. We don't believe that you have to die to become a saint. So we're not just talking about love for dead saints. It's easy to love dead saints because when dead saints are gone, you don't have to deal with them anymore. And you love the fact that they're gone. Somebody need to help you. This is what made the early church so amazing and so enticing to the ancient world. Barbarians and scythians and slaves and free, male and female, Jew and Greek, learned and ignorant folk came together and were all loved because that's what the church does. That's the power of the gospel when you love one another. There's nothing else more beautiful about sharing with folk love. You see, when you can share that love and when folk can feel that love, they don't have any problem coming to the church.
Amen.
Let's look at the demand of love. First of all, you know, genuine faith does not exist in a vacuum. When you talk about your faith, it does not exist in a vacuum. You can't just say, I believe and I have faith, and then walk away talking about you all by yourself in this thing, and I got to take care of myself, honey. I can't worry about other folk. I don't care what they do. It's not a vacuum. Amen, if you can. Just loving those lovable folk. But will inevitably result in changing your life. True faith will change your life. You can't just continue to be where you are. I told you before, when I went in the military, I come across young folk who came in and said, I came in a private, I'll leave out of private. Just nonsense. Amen?
Amen?
Some of us say, I came in full of hell, I'm going to leave out full of hell. Amen, if you can. They don't know me. And I've shared with you all these things before. But if you have true faith, it's going to make a change in your life.
Yeah.
You cannot continue to be the same person you were when you came into the church. Somebody need to help me. You know, it's kind of like getting into a marriage. And getting into a marriage. And you were a player. Somebody need to help me. You were a player before you came in to the marriage. Then you met the one that you thought was going to be the one for the rest of your life, but you still want to be a player. Are y'all still out there? I'm just trying to make it plain. You see, we're talking about love. But if you love that the person that you married, you're playing games. And if not, she will probably show you the door. Playing days are over. You cannot continue to be the same person you were when you came into the church if you have faith.
Yeah.
The Bible says old things are passed away. All things have become new. Now I am a new creature in Christ Jesus. So love the man that I make a change.
Yeah.
If I love her, then I'm going to get rid of all of my honeys. Amen, if you can. You know, one of the visible and strongest fruit of true saving faith is love for fellow saints. And brothers and sisters, I don't care if there's anybody in this region that you do not love, you are not practicing true Christianity.
Yeah.
I don't care what they did you.
Yeah.
I don't care how they burnt you. I don't care what they stole from you. I don't care what they said about you. I don't care what they did to you. You have to have love for them. Now, we'll talk about how that love should look. But I ain't reading the Bible, and you quoted it from your own lips. You said that it was not love for some of the saints, but for all of the saints. Amen. The lovable and the not so lovable. The Apostle John, turn over if you will, the First John with me. First John, we'll just stay there for a little while. You don't mind if I use the Bible this morning, do you? Let's turn over to First John and that third chapter. And drop down to about verse number 10, if you will. Come on, if you hurry up and say amen, like you understand, I can hurry up and get this thing over with. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 and verse number 10 in my Bible, in this the children of God are manifest and the children of the devil. Whosoever does not, righteousness is not of God, neither does he have love for the brethren. For the brothers. If you don't love your brother, you are not really practicing true Christianity. I don't care how many times you show up at church. I don't care how well you sing. I don't care how much money you give. I don't care how many things you do inside of the church. I don't care if you preach from the pulpit or just sit on a pew.
All right.
You don't love your brothers. You are not practicing true Christianity. You are not living out your faith. You're merely spinning your wheels, making yourself feel good. Amen. Because the Bible tells us, if you drop down to verses 14 and 15 in that same chapter, we know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. We're no longer dead in our sin because now we have love for the brethren. And I know that some of the folk get on your nerves. I know it, they get on mine too. Amen. I'm just going to be honest. Right? I'm not trying to lie. But that's not a prerequisite for me loving them.
Yeah.
And that they make me feel happy about them, because if they always make me feel happy, then my love really will never be tested.
Amen.
Say amen if you can. You can't really deal with it. I'll deal with it in a minute as I try to hurry up and get through this lesson. I'm going to try and help you this morning as much as I possibly can. But he said, we know that we have passed from death into life if we love the brethren. He that does not love his brethren is still dead.
Yeah.
Running around saying who you are and what you are and tagging yourself with all kinds of names. Hashtag Christian. Amen. You can tweet about it, but tweeting about it don't mean make it real. And you see, I don't need a self-report. I don't need you to tell me who you are. I need you to show me who you are. Help me, Holy Spirit. Amen. If you can. Verse number 14, so we know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loves not has his brother is still abiding in death. That's what he says in verse number 15, going on. Whosoever hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderers, is that what your Bible says? It says has eternal life. I said, if you hate your brother, you're holding that stuff in against your brother. But you don't understand, Brother Logic, and you just don't understand. I know I'm supposed to get there. Well, you're still murdering. Amen? And the reason why you're murdering them, you see, murder, death simply means separation. I'll say that again. Death means separation. And when you don't love somebody, you are separating yourself from them. So in essence, you are killing the relationship. And by killing the relationship, you are killing them. Because they are dead to you. Somebody need to help me. And that's why John said, you are a murderer. Because you are separating yourself from that person with your hatred. And your hatred will keep them dead to you. You know, you heard folks say, they're dead to me. You heard yourself say it too. And because they're dead to you, you have no relationship with them, and you might as well say that you're a murderer because you have killed them off. Somebody need to help me this morning. Somebody say, I love God and hate his brother. He's a liar. John tells it over in the fourth chapter in verse number 20, and there's no truth in there. If you say you love God and you hate your brother, you are a liar. And the Bible said that liars will not get into the kingdom of heaven as well. Did you say that? Folks, I'm trying to help you understand that this love stuff is very important. And if you can't get this love stuff together, well, you may not end up in heaven at all because you just can't get it together.
Amen.
And I know there are a lot of folks that you're dealing with on your job and in the church that you have issues with. But you need to get over those issues because those issues are hindering you from being all that you can be in the kingdom. I'm trying to help you this morning. The one who says that he's in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now. The one who says, I love his brother and abides in the light and there's no cause of stumbling in him is what John said in chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. He said, if you love your brother, you're walking in the light. You don't stumble over everything that your brother or sister do because you have love for them. And some of the stuff that folk do will get on your nerves. But because you have love for them, you have an appreciation for them. You see, it's like this. When your baby first came into this world, you had to teach your child how to walk.
Yeah.
Amen?
Right.
And some parents, good parents, don't get mad with their child because they fall down. Amen. Y'all look at everybody's friend. Let me move over here because I think I might have hit something. When your child fell down while you were trying to teach them to walk, you ran, "Oh, baby, that's okay, that's okay. Get up, come on. Mama love you, daddy love you, come on. You can do it, you can do it." But when folk in the church fall, babes in Christ fall. The Hebrew writer says when they have ought to be teachers, they have need that someone should teach them again, and they're going back to the first principle because they're still babes in Christ. They're still dealing with the milk. I don't care how long they've been sitting on the pew, they're still babes in Christ. And when they fall, we run over and say, "Well, you know, they're on their own. They just need to do what they're going to do because we need to go ahead on and get rid of that brother and that sister." I knew they were going to do that. Say amen if you can. But when you love somebody, you continue to be there for them. And, you know, sometimes they might do some things that will hurt you personally. Folk talk about you. Lie on you. What makes you so special? What makes you so special? They lied on Christ. They talked about Christ. They hung Christ on the cross. They nailed nails in his hand. They put a crown of thorns on his head. But before that, they beat him. They took him from judgment hall to judgment hall. Lying about it. And yet, he says, "Father, forgive them. Because they are babes. And they don't know what they're doing." So if you love and you walk in the light, then you have patience with one another. You don't just throw folk away because folk make mistakes or folk stumble. Now, I understand that some folk just do stuff and don't care, and they continue to do it over and over again, but there's a way to deal with them with love as well. It's called tough love there. You just have to tell them the truth and make sure they understand it.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
There's a way to deal with them without throwing them away.
Yes,
somebody need to help me. Yes. You see, true believers have a special love for everybody on earth.
So true.
We have a special love for everybody on earth. But we have a very special love for those who are members of the church. We love everybody in the world with a special love, you know. And we love everybody with that love, agape love. But we have a very, very, very special love for those who are members of the church. The Bible says, "Do good unto all men," but especially those who are of the household of God. You got to love us in a special way. You got to have some concession for us in a special way because we are special to you. Amen, if you can. You know, this is a striking point. It means that there is no room within the church. That it means that there is no room in the church. Are y'all still out there? There is no room in the church for division.
No room. No room.
We don't have room for division in the church. Just because you don't like the way something done doesn't mean that you got to divide over it. Say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We compare this, the church to marriage, because Paul compares it in Ephesians to marriage as well. He said, "Love, husband, love your wives as God loved the church." God don't just throw us away because we do something that's unsavory. Amen. Because we have a disagreement on something, God understands it and has patience with us. There's no room in the church for division. There's no room in the church for cliques. And let me just say something. Now, when I say cliques, I mean somebody. What a clique in my mind is not that you have somebody in the church that you have a special relationship with that you don't have with other folks. You cannot be friends with everybody in the same way. Jesus didn't have no cliques, but he did have three folk that he was closer to, and out of the three, he had one that he was closer. That was John, according to John. Amen. He also loved Lazarus and Mary and Martha. Amen. The Bible says when Lazarus died, the disciples came to him and said, "Him who you love has died." And he said, "No, he's just sleeping." So he had a special affinity with them. But when you talk about cliques is when you start excluding folk.
Yeah.
And don't practice including folk.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean that you can't have some special folk that you get along with better. There's always going to be that in the church. But when you start excluding folk and don't want folk to be invited in, then that's a clique.
Yeah.
Yeah. Amen. Shouldn't be any envying in the church. You know, you shouldn't want something just because somebody else got it.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
Shouldn't be no envy in the church. You shouldn't want something just because somebody else got it. If you can't do it, then leave it alone.
Yeah.
You know, that's why the Bible says that God gave to some to do certain things.
Yeah.
God gave to some special gifts to do certain things. There's some of y'all who can give more than me, and I don't envy you at all about that. Now some of you just have the ability to encourage better than I can. I don't have any issue with you doing that. I don't envy you for that. I just appreciate the fact that you're capable and able of giving me encouragement when I need encouragement. And some of you pray better than I pray. Sing better than I sing. Preach better than I preach. I don't have any problem with that because there should be no envy in the church. And you shouldn't want anything because that leads on from envy to covetousness. And we know that's a sin. Shouldn't be no grumbling in the church when you got love. Amen. Oh Lord, I should have left that one alone. Grumbling, I don't know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing either. And all of us don't know what us doing. Since us don't know what us doing, us don't know what us gonna do. Just grumbling. Amen. What are you grumbling about? I don't know, but I'm grumbling anyway. Just complaining about anything. And then complaining is not bad in itself, because sometimes complaining do show some things that are wrong. But when folk have fixed what you grumbled about, you ought to stop grumbling.
Yeah. Yeah.
I told them that they needed to put up some new curtains, and they went and got some blue curtains. Okay, we put up some new curtains. We didn't know you wanted blue curtains. But blue curtains do go with everything else we got. Say amen if you can. Just grumbling to be grumbling is not true love. Somebody need to help me. Shouldn't be any arguing in the church. You know, arguing about nothing. You know, some folks just love to argue. Folks who just love to hear themselves talk. And they'll just argue just to be arguing. And if you keep on arguing with them, you find out that they start arguing. You walk off, they start arguing with themselves. Say amen. Take it all the way to their car, arguing by themselves. Somebody need to help me this morning. Strife leaves the church when they have true love. Hard feelings leave the church when you have true love, because there's a special love for the brethren, and we continue to give the brethren the benefit of the doubt. I know that I'm not going to agree with everybody. Amen. And sometimes it just doesn't matter if I have my way or not. You know, my wife has a special way of saying it. Not always just won't bring her up, but she has a special way of dealing with something. I ask her, "What are we going to eat?" She say, "Food." And I can sit there and act crazy if I want to. The point is that you going to eat. You may not particularly like what you going to eat, but it will be food. I think that's the way we need to look at it in the church sometimes, because that will take away a lot of hard feelings. Sometimes we worry about, what are we going to do? How are we going to do this? How are we going to do that? We're going to get it done. It may not be to your satisfaction. It may not be exactly the way you crafted it and cut it out, but at least we got it done. Somebody can say amen. We're still doing the work of the Lord.
Say amen.
Bible says in John, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that also you love one another. Because by this saying shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. And if you don't have a love for one another, your gospel doesn't mean anything. See, we go around thinking about the gospel is giving us fire insurance, keeping us from going to hell. Can I get on? Can I get an amen? We're running around trying to teach folk the gospel of Jesus Christ. But faith, hope, and love is the power of the gospel. And love is what we ought to be sharing with folk. You see, the Bible teaches the gospel simple. And we always say, for God so loved the world.
Yeah.
That he gave his only begotten son. That whosoever loved him, whosoever believed in him will not perish but have everlasting life. The key is there that God loved the world.
Yes.
And he said, I need you to love one another as I have loved you. I gave myself for you.
Yes, sir. Yes.
That's the gospel.
Yes.
That you love one another. Running around with trying to get eternal life. Wouldn't it be a whole lot better if our lives would be better if we loved one another?
Yes.
More effectively? You see, folk don't want to come to the church because in the church, when you get to the church, everybody's arguing and grumbling and complaining about something, and there are cliques inside the church, there's strife inside the church, there are hard feelings inside the church, and then you talking about love one another. I don't see any love that you have for one another. You can't sell a bald-headed man. A bald-headed man can't sell hair tonic. Unloving folk can't sell love.
Yeah. Yeah.
Amen. If you can.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to help you this morning. This is my commandment, he says.
Yeah.
That you love one another as I have loved you. John 15 and verse number 12. Love. Let love be without dissimulation. And dissimulation really that means hypocrisy. All of that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Romans chapter 12 and verse number 9. He said, don't let it be with dissimulation. Don't let love be with hypocrisy. Let love be without play acting. You see, you can't play act too long. You can't be in a marriage very long and still got your honeys on the side and try to tell your wife that you love her. Amen. I keep saying it. I'm using that illustration because some of y'all know what I'm talking about. Amen. I use that illustration because I think that illustration plays specifically to how your understanding of love is, what hypocrisy is.
Yes.
You can't keep pretending that you love somebody and you don't actually demonstrate it really. Because after a while, you get tired of play acting.
Yes.
And that big argument comes. And you know what you say? I ain't never loved you anyway. Brother McGill and I get folk in our office. I have gotten folk in our office all the time. And after you get through talking to them, you figure out they never really loved each other. My question when I always deal with marriage counseling is this. First thing I always ask the couple, because after I listen to both sides, everybody's story is. One tell their story, the other one tell their story. And each one of them, when you finish listening to the story, the person who tells the story was right. I always ask them, is the marriage worth saving? Do you want to save this marriage? Do you want to be in a marriage? And sometimes folks just be honest and say, you know what? I really don't. And then they might just be even more honest and say, I never really loved him or her. I just did it because I didn't want to be alone. Hypocrisy. Now you understand hypocrisy? And you've been gone alone. They've been married 10, 15 years. Amen. But it's been a hypocritical marriage. That's what hypocrisy is. Hypocrisy is play acting. And folks, in the church, we cannot play act with our love.
Right.
You cannot just come in and say you have love for the brethren, and then all of a sudden, you just throw them away because something happens that you don't like. Can I keep on moving? Y'all look at me, my strength. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse number 12, because y'all been over there for a while. And the Lord makes you to increase and abound in love one toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you. seeing that you have purified the soul and obeyed the truth through the Spirit unto unfriends, love of the brethren. See that you love one another with pure hearts and fervently. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse number 22. Beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God, and everyone that love is born of God and know God. 1 John 4 and verse number 7. But let me just help you with a better definition of love, because some of you are still looking at me strange the way I was talking. How do you know that I'm practicing love toward one another? Well, there are nine simple ingredients that you can have. First of all, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, if you want to turn over there, if you will, you can turn over there, and I'll hurry up and go, and I think I might have to end on this morning. I still might not get the hope. Is that all right? I'm hoping that I will, but I don't know if I am or not. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, in verse number 4 and 7, the Bible says, love with patience. The Bible says, now that there are verse number 13, verse number 4, charity suffers long and is kind. Charity envies not. Charity vaunted not of itself. And it's patient. If you love somebody, you're going to have patience with them. You know, like I said, with your child trying to teach them how to walk, you don't immediately want them to jump up and start walking. You have patience with them. You walk along with them. You hold their hand.
Yes.
See, love is passive. It's not in a hurry. It suffers long. Bears, believes, hopes, and endures all things. That's patience. So if you want to love somebody, you got to have patience for them. And then love is in action is being kind toward one another. Mm-hmm. You see, being passive is I have patience with you. Passive means I don't have to be in action for me to show love to you. Sometimes I just got to sit back and let you do what you do. Be there and be supportive to you.
Yeah.
But then I need to put my love into action, and that means kindness. Never act rashly or insolent, not inconsistent or puffed up or proud around folk. You see, when you got to tell folk how great you are all the time, that's not love. If it's all about you, you don't have no love for anybody else. Amen. See, true love always try to help other folk be the best that they possibly can be. But when you don't love anybody else, everything has to be about you. And how do you know that everything has to be about you? Because you're always telling folk about you. And if you got to always tell folk about you, you don't have no love for nobody else but you. There's another word for that, and that's called narcissism.
So true.
Amen? And in case you don't know about narcissists, narcissist was a man who came along and love came along and narcissist was so caught up himself looking at his own reflection in the water that he couldn't look at anybody else. Amen?
Amen.
And if all you can see is you, if you like to hear your name called, amen. You know, I know all preachers who preach, the first time you preached and you went out and you were on one of these big lectureships in one of these symposiums or something, we all did it. We got the program and we wanted to see if our name was in it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So true. That one time.
Yeah.
You just wanted to make sure we were on the program, not because I just wanted to know that I was on there and I wasn't going to walk up there and be embarrassed. They were going to call my name. Amen.
Okay.
Wasn't necessarily because I was excited about seeing my name, but there was a certain joy in seeing my name on the program.
Okay.
Amen. But after a while, you shouldn't want to always see your name on the program. You shouldn't always want to have your name heard. It's not all about your name being heard, because that becomes narcissistic.
Yes. Yes.
That's not kindness toward other folk. That's always thinking about yourself. But love in action is showing kindness to other folk, promoting other folk above yourself.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Generosity. Love and competition. It's not envious or jealousy. It's generous. It means that you give so other folk can succeed and not so that you can succeed.
Right.
Amen, if you can. Humility, love and hide, not parade nor airing. Works and then retire. That's humility. And humility, if you really want to know what humility is, you don't always have to. You see, you can't say, I'm humble. Amen? That's not humility.
Yeah.
You don't have to go around telling folk you're humble. Because if you got to tell folk you're humble, you're not humble. Amen. That's just a simple test. I'm a humble person. No, you're not. You're a narcissist. Because you want everybody to know who you are. Amen. Love in society is courteous. It does not behave unseemly. Always polite at home and with all classes of folk. Not rude and not discontentious. Always trying to tear up stuff. Amen. Courteous. That's love. Love in essence is unselfishness. There's only one piece of candy. Well, take the candy out. For all you helping us, there's only one bowl of cake. And I know who's going to get it. It won't be me. Because I don't like cake. Amen. But if it's something I like, if it's candy, you might have a fight with me. But unselfish love, and that's love's essence, is unselfish. It's not selfish. It's not sour. It's not bitter. It's not seeking. It seeks only the good of others and does not retaliate or seek revenge. That's courtesy. See, I'm not trying to get folk. You know the Bible says, vengeance is mine, said the Lord. And I need to let the Lord do what the Lord do. And if the Lord let you go, I need to let you go.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yes.
If God didn't punish you, that's good enough for me. You know, and I'm not going to wait to see if you're going to make it to hell. Amen? Because I might end up in hell. I never know if you made it to hell. Somebody need to help me. Love in its disposition is a good temper. Never irritated. Never resentful. I'm so sorry that he got that. I wanted that job. I'm sure sorry they got that job. I wish I had gotten it, but you know, I'm really sorry they got it. You know, I wanted that bad. Resentful. Amen. And I resent the fact that they're doing well and I'm not doing well. You know, see somebody drive up in a nice car, have a nice suit. Amen. Family look like it's doing well. You're resentful. Irritated over it. Amen. That's love disposition. That's not a good temper. Y'all still got time?
Mm-hmm.
Two more and I'm going to quit. Love and conduct. Never boastful. And conceited.
Yes.
Not a hypocrite. Always honest. This is sincerity, folks.
Yes.
Love never impresses. Love leaves no impression, but wants strictly truth, never self-assertive, does not blaze out in passionate anger, nor brood over wrong, always just, joyful, and thankful, knows how to be silent, full of trust, always present. That's sincerity. Don't always have to share what you think. Amen. You see, sincerity say, I don't always have the last word. Because let me tell you why folk always want to have a last word. Many times when folk always want to have a last word is because folk always think that they are more intelligent, smarter, and superior. And they think that they're going to close it out with the last word. And if you always got to have a last word, then you are not really a sincere person. Because you always think, and once again, narcissistically, that you are the best. And when you say it, that's it. Everybody else gets to shut up. Say amen if you can. That's not sincerity. Now there are times when you may be the one who needs to say the last word. And if y'all hadn't figured it out for me in my Bible class, I always do it, and I'm going to tell you my secret. I always do it in the Bible class. I always say, anybody want the last word? That's why I do that. Now, it ain't going to work anymore. Because I know there are some folk who want to have the last word. And I feel like they should have it. If they got to have it that bad, they should have it. Amen. Let me close this thing out because I think I've been going too long. What is love? Love is silence. When your words will hurt somebody. You keep your mouth shut when your words will hurt somebody. So love does not always have to tell everybody. Sometimes, well, I'm just telling them the truth. I got to tell it like it is. We got to tell them the gospel truth. Well, you know, sometimes your gospel truth is not really the gospel truth that's in the gospel. Amen. So sometimes love is silent when the words were heard. It's patient when your neighbors is hurt. It's deafness when scandals flow. When folk are talking about folk, you turn a deaf ear to it. You don't need to get all the detail. What? What was that? He did what? She did what? That's not love. Love doesn't want to hear gospel. You just keep on moving. You keep your mouth shut. You're patient with your neighbor. You're deafness when scandal is flowing. It's thoughtfulness when another is in woe, when somebody is in trouble. You're thoughtful enough to go over and ask, do you need some help? And don't just say it. Sometimes folks say, well, whatever you need, you know, you can call on me. You go over to somebody's house and you see the grass need cutting. You don't tell them, well, show them that your grass need cutting. You just call on me if you want me to come cut it. Cut the grass! Dishes need washing. Go ahead on and wash the dishes and stuff. They say, well, the house sure was in a mess. You know, I might get a little mad with you if you come over and help start cleaning up my house, but after you leave, I'll probably say, after I say some charged things about you and I get back in Jesus. Amen. You know, love is not easy. So I might have to step back into Jesus and remember all the stuff that I've been preaching you. Amen, if you can. And it's thoughtfulness. It's when somebody else is in trouble. It's promptness when stern duty is called. Love says that when I see there's some need in the church, I don't have to be begged to do it. Amen, if you can. It is courage when misfortune falls. And the epigram, I think that anybody can be a cardiologist. Anybody can be a heart specialist. All of us can be heart specialists. The only requirement is loving somebody. You just need to be a love meister. Just go out and love somebody, and you can be a cardiologist. Anybody can do that. Love comes into a desert and makes it blossom like a rose garden. When love comes in, you don't have to worry about it because love is going to make everybody feel good. Amen. Love can enter a dark, dingy hut and make it look like a royal palace. Love can take a simple sandwich and make it taste like a king's palace. I remember when I was little, I fell in love with mayonnaise sandwiches. Some of y'all don't know what I'm talking about. Some of y'all are kind of saying, but Elijah, you don't eat that. That's full of cholesterol. But when I was little, that's all I would eat. That's all I would eat. My mom would cook these elaborate meals, and she'd ask me, what do you want? I want a mayonnaise sandwich. And she'd take that mayonnaise sandwich and cut it in four pieces and make it look like a banquet meal. And it wasn't nothing but mayonnaise and bread. Somebody else say amen. And I'd eat that and be just as content with all this food flowing on the table. But she'd take that mere sandwich and make it something because she wrapped it in her love.
Yeah.
She didn't try to force me and say, boy, you ought to eat this and you ought to eat that and you ought to do that. I was a little skinny fella then, and they used to give me the weight on tablets and try to make me get a little bit fatter. Hey, amen. I wish they hadn't never done that. Amen. Love can take an old dress and transform it into a beautiful wedding gown.
Yeah.
Love can reach into an orphanage and cause it to become a castle. Love can enter a dull daily routine and make the hour rush past. And love can capture the heart filled with grief and loneliness and saturated with confidence and joy. And I'm talking about love now. Love can take the ugly and make it beautiful, the sad and make it glad. The difficult and make it easy, the burden and make it light, and the dull and make it interesting, the bad and make it good. And love can also take the meager and make it much.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I'm talking about love.
Yes.
Those who love will have no need to be begged. Those who love will have no need to be begged. to assist the weak. They'll have no need to be begged to help the helpless. You don't have to beg folk who have love to comfort the lonely, to forgive the offender. You don't have to beg folk to welcome the prodigal back home. You don't have to beg folk to lift up the fallen. There's no need to beg folk to win lost folk to Christ. Amen? Because if you have love in your heart, you're going to go out and do what you need to do. I'm not going to get the hope today, but I hope y'all have patience with me. You know, love is like that. You can see love in action. Love is not just about chalk, and you don't have to beg folk to do something when they know they ought to do it. I remember, I believe it was Brother Lane used to say, and I thank Jerry for taking us back to old Berkeley days this morning when with Psalm 100. He took us back to Berkeley days. I like that. And so, you know, Brother Lane, you say, don't make me beg you to do what you know you already need to do. You know, if you know that you need to go out and do something, if there's somebody that you got something that you holding against, you know, you need to go ahead on and call them up. I remember the Bible says you bring your gift to the altar and leave it there. If you have an altar with your brother, you go back and get it right with your brother, because you can't come in here talking about how holy you are and there are folk out there that you hate. You cannot talk about how holy you are when you got some hate in your heart for folk that you still got something against. You got to go out there and get it right with them first, and then you come up in here and talk. Because folk, it's not about bringing in your gifts to the altar that God is concerned about. God says, I prefer obedience rather than sacrifice.
Yes.
And what he's saying there is, you're not being obedient in the fact that I told you to love one another. I told you to do some things, and you don't want to do those things, but you want to come in and make a show. Amen? Got my offering. Oh, Lord. Now don't y'all stop giving. But what I'm saying to you is that God is not concerned about you making a big show about stuff when you don't want to do anything to love your brothers and sisters in Christ. If you got faith, the power of the gospel is, out of your faith comes your love. And because of that, you'll have some hope. Your hope will end up when you get into heaven. But the point is, you got to go through your faith first. And then you got to demonstrate your faith. Because your faith is tied up in how you love one another. If you can't love one another, then you're not really demonstrating the faith that you say you have. You're merely going through the motions, and you're putting on the show. And it's all good and dead. You know, folk used to, I seen a guy downtown one day, and he was sitting down, and he had his legs bent behind him. And he stayed there, and I stayed down there for a long time, waiting on Martin to come pick me up, and his legs were bent behind him, and then 5 o'clock came, he got up.
Right.
He stood up. And I wanted to walk over and give him a dollar. Because anybody who could do that long deserved a dollar. He put on a good shirt. Man, I get down there like that, I would never get up after 3 or 4 hours. I would never get up. My legs be so numb and they'd have to come pry me up. I sat down, now I just stayed there for about 5 minutes and I get hunting and grunting. But he got up and straightened his leg out and went on about his business. I'm like, I just come to St. Louis, and I wasn't used to that. We don't do that stuff in Louisiana like that. They don't have that kind of folk. I'm like, wow! This is amazing! I mean, I just want to give the guy a dollar just because he had put on a good show. And I mean, I stood there and I watched him. I believed that he was crippled. And he wasn't. And I think sometimes we do stuff like that in the church. We come in and we put on this good show and we demonstrate a lot of things out in public that we will not do in private. And it's not about what you do. The true test of your character is not what you do when other folks see you, but when folk don't see you, how you behave and act. Amen? And if you're holding something against somebody, you need to go ahead on and get it together. If you help, you can't have patience with one folk. You're not envious of everybody. You're not jealous of everybody. You don't have cliques. You're not excluding folk out because you think you're better. You don't always have to have a last word because you think you're superior to other folk.
Yeah.
That's not love. Love doesn't do all those kind of things. Love has patience to try to bring everybody up to beyond them, esteeming others higher than ourselves. Is what Paul says over in Philippians, you know, esteeming our brothers better than us. Think of everybody as being more than you and having more than you. I don't care what kind of education you got.
Yes.
Amen. Yes. Even Einstein, the smartest man in the world, still needed a plumb. You need somebody.
Yes.
You don't know everything. You can't do everything. You need somebody, and your love will secure that fellowship with one another. Brother, you get ready to sing a song. I'm done. Come on. Because I keep going and they'll be looking at me like I'm strange up here. So if you're here this morning, you've been holding something against somebody, you've not been loving one another like you should be loving one another, then you need to come down, get it right. You don't have to tell us who you hating on. Amen. That might be too many information. It might be me. But if you are, then you need to come to me and ask me if you want forgiveness, ask me for forgiveness. You may want to share what it is. And it may not even have to come to me. Just start treating me right.
Yes. Yes.
You may not have to say anything. Just start treating me the way that you want to be treated. You know, the golden rule. Do unto others as you would have them to do unto you. Just start doing unto me as you would have me to do unto you. And then I think everything will be all right. Turn that in the sandbox, D. Where it comes from the Bible. Amen. Go ahead, my brother. Let us stand while we sing the song of invitation.
Yield not to temptation.